Yes, it is visible. Yeah, Arvind, it's we are good to go now. Okay, recording has been started. Over to you.
Yeah, so hello everyone. So far we had three sessions on Moki so far. So in this session we will be taking up the basic framework architecture. I'll be discussing about a bit on basic framework architecture of Moki, outer layer of it, like mental business artifacts that are written on top of it and is a separate product. Then after that, we'll be move on to how to write services in Moki. So first, let's start on the Moki, a bit on the Moki framework itself. So Moki is basically a enterprise ready framework which can be used to develop any kind of application. It is not written in a way of object oriented model or object oriented way, rather in service based model. Each service is actually a granular part which does something to perform some action, and all those parts in combination, when we use those in such a way that it performs certain business process, then that can be used to develop your application, ERP application, all that. So here in this diagram, as we can see that on the center of the framework, its setting is Moki framework, then a mental business artifacts. So mental business artifact is basically has three parts, UBPL, Universal Business Process Library, USL, and UDL. UBPL is basically documentation of processes that are not available elsewhere in a way like which we can refer to. So what Moki community has done is to collect all those processes as much as possible, not necessarily the complete ones, but how it is used in Moki. So UBPL consists of the business processes, and it's a library or the documentation of processes that are supported. It is written away like actors and their actions in that way. UDM is basically the universal data model that is on top of Moki, which is actually implemented, taking a cue or implemented and further used and expanded with the universal data model volume 2. Then there is USL, which is dependent on UDM on the code level and uses the processes that are defined there in UBPL. So that is the basic introduction of what's the mental business artifact. So if you go to mental business artifact, it is listed down here like the basic parts. It is mental has three main parts: universal data model, universal service library, and universal business process library. So when we use as Moki is a framework and that can be used to develop anything, why do we need actually the mental business artifacts? These are to speed up any development that you are going to do with any other organizations. Like if you are going to develop an ERP system, a CRM system, a SCM system, or point of sale system, or are going to develop an e-commerce website. So if you want to speed it up and use the mental business artifacts, then you can speed up your development process, as there are lots of processes that are already developed and are available open source. So we'll be going to the business process library UBPL. As you can see here, there are lots of processes that are listed down here. I think it is visible to everyone, the font. If there is any problem, please let me know. As I've gone through mental business artifact, then there is business process library. And if I select, there is the processes that are listed down the left side of business process library. All these processes are available in the form of, it is a story. Basically, every process is a story where there is an actor and his actions are defined. So as I opened up the account reviews, invoice and send payment, it is a story which defines supplier sends invoice and all that. So these are all can be accessed from here. And these are implemented under USL library. As we all know, Mental UDM, the universal data model that is written on top of data model resource book by Silverstone, Glenn Silverstone. So it contains a lot of entities and their relations and all that. Then let's move on to the USL business processes. Here there isn't much of documentation available around here. It's just this sound that these processes are the standard processes and supports the functionalities like procure to pay, order to cash, and work plan to cash processes. So if you go down to the list down here, we can see that it supports basically the services that are written in USL, supports purchase and sales orders, project tasks, request management, etc., incoming outgoing invoices, automatic invoice generation, so on and so forth. So these are available, and there is a link down in the document that we can access. Yeah, so on this page, this is on the demo MOOC instance that we can access, and here all the services are listed down. We can go to any service and see the details, like what is written in that service. It's generated Groovy. That is a great part. Like you can access the generated Groovy that is being used and cached into the architecture of the framework and being used. So here there is some detail of that service, what is the input parameters, what are the out parameters, what it does, and some more details. So these are the service lists that can be accessed and used for your reference. Now we'll be moving on to Mookie framework, and basically the services, logic and services, how to write services, types of services available in the Mookie framework and all that. So yeah, so here the main headings are like service definition, all that. So let's go to service definition. So Mookie framework, the main unit of logic, as I mentioned earlier, like Mookie framework is written in a way, not in object oriented or the object model way, rather in service way. And each service is a granular part which do something which we can use. So there is collection of services. If we use them in a way to perform certain action or the process, then we can achieve the business processes that we wanted to, or that are listed in the UBPL or Universal Business Process Library. So these are the service definition. So how a service is defined. So I'll take an example that is listed down here is, each service has three parts, a path in which it is residing in a file, then there is a verb that is the action that it does, and a noun. A noun can be anything. It can be name of an entity on which, if it is a standalone service and working on a single entity, then the noun can be a name of an entity. Or if it is performing some certain action or performing a process, then name of that process. And a verb. Verb can be anything from create, update, delete, store that are available for auto services. Apart from that, you can use other verbs as well, and those are available. Yeah, so here, as we can see, a service is written down here where a verb is used, create, a noun is person, and this person can be an entity as well. It's in parameters and all that. So if you go through this documentation, here it is very well defined what are all parts of a service. So first the verb, how this service can be called, like the path, then verb, pound symbol, and then noun. Pound symbol is optional here, and you can use it or not, as well as the noun. So a service can have just a verb and not a noun. So that is here. The definition of verb, noun, type, location, method, authenticate, all these details allow remote, like we are allowing the service to be accessed from outside the system, validation, transaction, and all these details are available there that can be accessed. Here is the basic service definition that we have talked about. Let's go on to the service implementation part. So for service implementation, there are certain types. You can use an inline service, a script. Right now we usually use Groovy, but any DSL script can be used, Java methods, or entity auto services. Apart from that, any other runner can also be implemented into the framework and can be used. Yeah, so let's move on to service scripts. So as mentioned, like inline actions, Java methods, entity auto services, all that. And the good thing with Moki is, like, for auto services, you don't need to add definition on implementation for there. If you use create, update, store, or delete as a verb and the entity name as a noun, and you want to perform any action, any such action of create, update, delete, or store on any, you can directly call it and don't need to actually specify it or define it. There is a service script that is definition of service script is being mentioned here. This is a service tag which defines a service, then a verb send, and a noun email. So what we can understand here, this is working on an email to send it, and the type is script. As we are not using inline here, if we are using inline, we don't need to actually define the location of that script. We are using type of script here, so we need to define where that script actually resides. So the next thing is location. Location has a class path, and the class path is basically a Java package type of structure. Here, the class path is ORSB Moki implementation and send email template.groovy. And allow remote is false. By default, allow remote always is false. So they actually don't need to actually define it. But if you wanted to make it true and make the service accessible from outside, then you can do it. And this implements a service send email template. So here. Yeah. And inline actions. I'm just mentioning it, and then we'll be going into the actual code to see how they are all implemented. So inline actions, there are inline services as well, which are written in XML. There are certain elements that are available there, which can be used to write the service in XML. Ultimately, what will happen is that XML will be converted into the Groovy. While runtime, that Groovy will be converted into a class file and loaded into the cache. So ultimately, they will be as fast as Java because the class file will be loaded into the cache. Then there are Java methods. So when you are defining a service as a Java method, you can write that Java code inside script, and then that method that you are writing, that should return a map and take execution context as an input parameter. Execution context is basically a combination or collection of all the records that are available there, and you can access all the parameters, the request response objects, user authentication, all that from execution context. Then the entity auto service, as I have mentioned, we don't need to define actually entity auto services. If you wanted certain assumptions or certain things to happen with the input output parameters, you can define them as well. And here is the execution call for entity auto service. So execution context service sync, this is being called in sync. So, and name is create and example. Create is a verb and example is the noun. So that must be a service name or can be an entity as well. Add your own service runners. I won't be taking this right now because after writing the basic services and all that, you can add actually your own runner framework level and implement it. Next, we will be taking into calling services, how to call the services. So here, the example that is listed down here basically contains a map PHP defined, which has certain values put in here. This service here, the execution context.service has calling a service in async mode. So it will not be sync. And then name of that service is, by seeing it, you can see like it is an auto service, which is working on artifact hit entity and performing the verb or action create. And ASP parameters are paused and it's being called. Then the next execution call is for a service which is called in sync. So when you are calling a service in async mode, it doesn't return anything. So you are not actually looking at anything that the service returns. However, when you are calling it in sync, it returns a map with the values that are passed from there. So here, execution context is calling a service in sync with create user account, and parameters are passed here. So beyond the basic models, we have different ways to calling a services. So first one is synchronous mode or the sync mode. Here, the available parameters that you can pass or the things that you can set up is require new transaction. If you wanted to run your service in a new transaction, then the parent one. The multi, if you are using a multi service, disable auths if you don't want your service to be running just for the authenticated users. Then the second one is async. That is basically asynchronous mode and runs on in any time when the CPU cycles are available. So it has call future and distribute methods. There is another special. So special doesn't have a call method and it has available register on commit or register on rollback. So on the transaction commit or rollback, this can be called and to perform certain business processes that are required. And there are jobs which can be scheduled into the system using the clone expressions. And you can define those clone expressions. These can be performed by adding data. Here is this, it's data is prepared for service jobs which are scheduled into the system, and based on the clone job and the expression that defines when it will run, it works that way. Then there are service jobs, as I mentioned. A service job can be maintained and a clone expression can be used there to execute it in the future. So all those details are available here that can be accessed from this document. There are service ICA rules or the event condition action rules that can be used to execute on the completion or the actions of a service or on the actions of entities. So all those details are available here. And if you are going to write inline services in XML, here are some details of the XML actions that are available to write those inline actions. So here are the attributes which are available. So these are actually extracted from the XFCT information. And I think it will be better to actually, yeah, there is a question from Namit Jain here. Do we need to restart Mochi server to see changes in inline or Groovy services in effect? There is a cache refresh time here that is defined. I haven't done it, but we can definitely ask someone who is more familiar with the framework whether it is required or not. Right now, yeah. Yep, so as we are discussing, the inline services, yep, so all the tags that are listed down here, those can be used. And in my opinion, it will be better to actually use the XSD definition available there, that as it has more information, what are all the things that are actually available to be used, the restrictions and all that. So XSD can be accessed by going into a service file, copying the schema location from here, and then opening that on the web browser. So that is available. Now we will go into the example component that I have copied over here in the component directory. So if you see this structure, there is a service folder available or service directory available over here, and a script directory available over here.
Sorry to interrupt, but I think screen is not refreshed here. We aren't seeing you in IDE as of now.
Okay.
We see the browser window where you have opened the XSD.
Namit, I think Arvind, I think you shared only one window, not the entire screen. So it might possible.
So share the entire screen, that way you'll be able to share the IDE view as well. You'll need to stop it here.
Yeah, again, that same problem. I'm not able to actually share the whole screen. What I'll do is share the.
As you get that option, that window, pop-up window, where you are asked, you want to share a whole screen or you only want to share a specific.
Window? I'm sharing whole screen, but the option to share that is actually disabled, so I can't do that.
You'll need to select that actually, Arvind.
No, I'm trying that, but it is coming at disabled.
Now what would be it? See, when I click on this option called present now in the right bottom right corner, yeah. I see three options: your entire screen, a window, a Chrome tab. There are three options. Are you seeing three options?
Yeah, I'm seeing all those three, and I'm when I'm selecting the first one, your entire screen, mm-hmm. and there comes a pop-up window. On that window, the share is disabled.
Yeah, for that, yeah, that's why I'm saying you will need to click on that screen in
Okay. Yes. Is it visible?
Yes, it's visible now. And now you go to your IDE, I think it will work. Yes.
Yeah.
You're able to see it.
So, yeah. Let's start over. So as I mentioned, like I have copied an example component inside the runtime and component. Here, you as you can see, there are a script tag, script directory available, as well as service directory. So all the service definition and their implementation, inline implementation, resides under the service directory. Here you can use a folder structure. Like here, I have a service under which a Moki directory, then an example directory. And it works like a Java package structure. So each after service, the Moki.example will become a package like structure. So let's open the example services. Here. So as you are seeing, like, So for inline services, there is this documentation available where all the tags and details are defined. Apart from that, if you wanted to see the complete picture and all the descriptions of things that are available to you, you can actually go to the XSD of that and see like all the elements, their allowed values, and all this information is available here. Then let's discuss about service implementation here. So here there is an entity auto service that is being defined here. So as I mentioned, like for entity auto, you can use create, update, delete, and store as a verb. And the noun must be the name of an entity. Here, display name is an optional thing that you can use or not. Then type is entity auto, and allow remote is true. So this can be accessed from outside system as well. So here, the in parameters we have taken. So this is how an auto service is actually defined and implemented. So however, you don't need to define it. It is available automatically in Moki. But if you want certain fields to disable, enable, or send certain extra parameters out, then or restrict some, you can define this service. The second one is also an auto service. Then let's talk about a service with TypeScript. So here, as we can, a test service is written down here. It has a verb text. As I mentioned, like if you are writing your own services, and it need not be the verb need not be one of the create, update, delete, or store. It can be anything. So here, the verb used is test, and the noun is create example service, which is not an entity, rather a noun. So it defines what this service actually does. And then if you are using type as script, then you need to give the location of that script. Here, component example script was the Moki. This is the path of the service, script location. And we can go to here and see its implementation. So here on service is defined over here. So which contains the use of certain elements like service call and all. So that is being used. Similarly, yeah, so I think that that is all from the service point of view as far as the example component is concerned. We can also move on to the USL library that we have discussed earlier, the mental USL. And there are lots of services that are implemented over here that are listed in the documentation as well. So here, the structure, as you can see, is the structure is similar to Java package. So all the service definition must be inside a service directory under your custom component. which can be listed according to their uses. Like here, account facilities, different directory structures are created, and those will become the service path, for the execution of those services. Here, if you go to facility and open the facility services, we can see the implementation over here of all these services. Here we have used a get verb and a facility as noun. Here on the in parameters, we have all the parameters, then out parameters have what you wanted to send out. And then by default, as the service, if you have not defined what the type of the services is, it is always inline. So for inline services, you need to actually define the actions where all the tasks are, or the business processes are performed. Here, there is a script tag where you can write your Ruby code and the tags, XML tags that that can be used to write the inline service. So here are enough details available over here, which can be accessed and used. So I think that's it from my side for this session. We are open to questions if there are any.
Yeah, we have a question from Deepak asking for the overriding feature for a service.
Yeah, so actually we I haven't actually gone through that far, and we haven't put that as part of this session, but I think Deepak himself can define it better.
Deepak passed a smiley here. Anyway, no worries. For sure there might be a way to
I also haven't not tried it yet, but yes, if we can define the same package hierarchy in the your custom component, then it might possible that you can override the service implementation and its definition. But still, it's not tried yet. So we haven't
come across such implementation yet.
Yes.
Why we don't know it? Yes. Well, any other question?
Arvind, can you please show some example from script where we can call this service and all sort of thing? From script tag and how can we call the services inline from inline script?
So in USL, there are lots of services available, and service call. So here is a service. Deepak, you can see my screen?
Yes, Arvind, we can see your screen. I have muted Deepak. We can see it.
These are the under actions we can from inline services, we can definitely call the other services as well. Here are the certain mentions of the service. You'll find a lot of examples like these in USL component, as it has a vast variety of services, already implemented services.
Arvind, here I am talking about the entity context dot pattern. This is the XML text to call the services. There is another pattern in which you can call the service from a Groovy or the Java code. The pattern is different. So if you could share those, it would be helpful.
Just give me a moment. I don't think that file contains that sort of actually script calling. I'll quickly check.
Let me just give a name of the file. If you would like to open it, Arvind, asset services.xml, line number 782.
No, it is
Yes, it has the EC dot service dot sync and dot name pattern.
It is available here on the asset services.xml, and under the condition tag here we have so it is basically execution but it's there it's called inside the form tag, and users actually the setting value, but we can take this example, like we can call the service from here. Deepak, is this what you are looking for?
Actually, I also think this would be the same way you will be using when you call in an inline service in Groovy or a Java file. Where you had to call in, and you also took an example here in this document. We were talking about the execution context and how can you call the sync and async services. This one where you had prepared a map and then you were passing it in earlier one, where you were preparing a map and you were passing it in here.
Here it is available.
This is the way where how you use it in Groovy or maybe in a Java file if you need to.
Right.
So mostly in Mocky, what happens is like mostly the CRUD-like services are there, and we'll as we dig in further, we'll find more and more examples of business process implemented therein, and there might be plenty of examples already being there. So as we refer those, we'll get the similar patterns of calling in services. Async in line and preparing the context or the maps and passing it to services for execution and implementing the logics if you need to, right? Obviously you should first be searching for the existing implementation, and you must always be trying to use what you already have available with the framework, and then after enough of brainstorming you should take a call on doing the implementations or writing wrapper services or clubbing up services for performing certain processes. So maybe Mocky will be doing better here, and you won't need that much of customization. But Mocky also gives you the flexibility to customize it based on the requirement. So well, any other questions? Any other questions or thoughts or anything, okay? Not necessarily need to be a question, okay? So please feel free to put up any thoughts. So my thought here, Arvind, in the meantime, we are waiting for some questions. Here, my thought, Arvind, would be to do some more granular, smaller sessions. We don't need to be going for a 1 hour webinar here. That's my thought is, like, we can pick up small topics like this one, calling inline services, how many ways are there, how can you do it, from where we can do it, and what are the best practices around it, which has been which should be used. If it is not documented, we can document it, and at the same time we can put up those documentation in front of community and see if there is a chance it can be helpful to the developers, and we can contribute it to the community as well. That's my thought, and doing the smaller sessions will also help the people who are watching the videos and learning Mocky. Will also give them an idea on best practices that we learn as we go further. So here's an interesting question from Namit, Arvind, if you saw it. Amit is saying that, okay, is there any pre or post processors thing like we have in OIBiz, where you have pre and post processors that you implement?
So Amit, here you are talking in context to controller request sort of thing, not in context of service, right?
Yes. Okay.
So let me answer this question. Yes, you can write the pre and post processor. You can refer the mockyconf.xml file where you can define the webroot section, and on that part you can define your pre post processor and the custom servlet and context filter, all sort of thing. So for that thing you need to refer mockyconf.xml xsd, and you can find all sort of thing there.
Yeah, as we don't have the controller thing, it might help many of us.
that's why
from OFB's background, that's also a tricky thing to map things in Mocky, right? That's where you're confused, and that's where you had to dig in further and read out all. Yes.
So Pranay, if you go to the Mocky website, there is a section where David mentioned the comparison between Mocky and OFB's. So it's clearly laid out how OFB's pattern and how it works in Mocky. So we can easily find those there who are from the OFB's background and easily map the OFB's things with the Mocky.
Yeah, that is a good help actually. Everyone must refer it. Yeah. There is a comment from Namit. Okay, will it be the same thing, Deepak? What's your thought on that? Namit is comparing what we have as a precondition, pre-action and post-action in screen. Is it the same thing or like...
we can say that, but this is with respect to particular screens transition, not for the whole application sort of thing. Like in case of for the auth token authentication or sort of thing, that should at the web app level. So this is the similar thing, but it's in context of a specific screen.
Yes. Okay. So I think we can close it here. Thank you so much, Arvind. It was a very helpful session. We are progressing bit by bit. By every session, we are getting stronger on this front. We are learning more and more. So, yeah, as I said, we can definitely dig in further, and we should be planning on the smaller ones if you find it comfortable doing. We'll pick smaller topics and then we'll go from there. So maybe in future, we'll be doing even smaller sessions. Let's say 15-20 minutes will be more than enough. We'll be engaging all the participants for that much of time, and we'll learn something and we'll go. And then maybe we can do a couple of sessions in a day or so. So maybe that can be a good strategy here. Yeah, but we will figure out as we move further.
So team, I just shared the link that I found, the comparison of Mocky and OFB's. How does it compare to Mocky? Right, so we can refer that part, and after reading this, we can easily map things with the Mocky and can figure out how it works in Mocky.
Yeah, it's definitely a really good document. Every one of us must go through it. Thank you, Deepak, for sharing it.
Thank you, Pranay.
Okay, so yeah, thank you, Arvind, and thanks to all the participants who spared their time this morning. And we look forward to your feedback and questions or any sort of discussion that we can do on Mocky mailing list. You can refer to the community development page that we are always sharing on the YouTube channel, where we are sharing the videos. We can come up with the discussion and topics on the Mocky mailing list. At the same time, you can put up your questions on the videos as well on YouTube. But we would highly recommend if you can carry on the discussions on Mocky mailing list itself. So thank you so much once again. Have a nice day.
Thank you, Arvind.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.